And I will not let fear shake the king off the throne of my heart. I will not let hate stop the king from sitting on my heart. I will not let lowliness of conversation cause me to remove the king from my heart. I don't care who's in office. They control the White House, but God controls my house. My help don't come from Washington, my help comes from the Lord. And I think it's a good thing that the Lord shake you up, because your faith was in the wrong expectation. That God can prosper you in the midst of a famine, because the Lord sits high and looks low. The Father is who I worship. The Father is who I serve. So it says, Matthew 6's gospel says, disciples to know how to pray, so they don't get it twisted and think that it's everybody else that's sustaining them. So when you pray, I want you to pray in this manner. Father, give us this day. Stop you from seeing the goodness of God. Go to bed. Don't worry about the Facebook prophets. My economy is stimulated by God alone. And we have natural roles to play. I'm not trying to put it off on the spirituality side. But you're making this bigger than what it is. Like, you've made it this far. God's not just going to drop off the face of the earth and forget who you are. The king sits on the throne of his people's heart. And God can favor, Proverbs 21 says, the 20 says, the heart of the king. I want y'all to put that up there, because it's Proverbs 21 verse 1. In the Lord's hand, the king's heart is a stream of water that channels towards all who please him. It's one simple prescription. If my people that are called by my name, like, look at that emphasis. If my people who are called by me, not the Democratic name, not the Republican name, not the independent name, if my people that I call by shall humble themselves. Because sometimes we think our authority comes from us. We're living because of us. But if we would humble ourselves, not post about everything, just pray and let God do what he does. I'm not only out here fighting with everybody. The king sits on the throne of my heart. He did not get evicted just because somebody won an election. It didn't matter who was in office. The king sits on the throne of my heart. Can you be disappointed? Absolutely. Can you be sad? Whatever. That's fine. But to go to the point of despair. My kids didn't go to sleep concerned last night. They knew that daddy will figure it out some way. They skipped into bed because they knew that daddy got this. This is not going to change my life, my season. And so God is looking at his children saying, I thought that was the king of your life. What did it expose? Did it expose the level of deviancy and racism? Yes. But it also exposed where people's trust is at. Now we see everybody running back to Jesus. I'm going back to church. I'm going to seek the Lord. I'm going to find God. Has walked through something where they now have to put their confidence in something greater than themselves. Grandma's leaving the earth. Grandpa's leaving the earth. It's time for this generation to mobilize their faith and stop thinking that your job is your source. A stimulus is your source. No, God is the one that gives you the ability from within. Before this even happened, God had already arranged for us to come together and pray and seek His face. It wasn't for an election, it was for your faith. To not be afraid, to not be scared. That's not the type of God that we serve. He's not in heaven freaking out trying to figure out what's going to happen. He's so much so numbered the hairs upon your head. That you cast your cares upon me. Sunday I'm talking about Uzziah. And Uzziah was king. The people of God could not see God till Uzziah died. And it's when Uzziah died that they start to see God high and lifted up. We gotta take these idols down that we believe are going to do everything for us. I'm not saying that we don't have a responsibility, but I'm saying we gotta take this ideology that we're hoping and trusting that everybody's going to do for us. This is what we do. And God is doing this what we do. If my people in 1 Chronicles 7:14, if they just humble themselves, and trust in your own ability, and just sit there and pray alone, and correspond with action. We feel your fear. We feel your concern. Whether you wanted this one or that one, I just wanted to remind you again, you're God's children. The King sits on the throne of your heart. He's not moved by what's happening. You're losing your focus. You're getting distracted on the things that don't matter. You're coming down off the wall to lower yourself to conversations that you don't even have to entertain. You're spending so much time trying to defend what you think that you're forgetting what you know. If you look at my preacher, I ain't tripping, I ain't going back and forth with nobody. I ain't got much to say about it. Because my eyes was never on the left to the right. I did my part. I did what I'm supposed to do. But at the end of the day, I gotta keep moving. I'm not moving nowhere. God's no problem with me right here. Right here. Right here. I'm not going to no other island. This is where God called me. This is where God assigned me. He will prosper you where He assigned you. Bless you when He assigned you. He will establish you when He assigned you. He will glorify His name through you when He assigned you. All it is an attempt to get you to move out your assignment and the confidence and the conviction that you have. If God called you to something, He didn't call you to run and hide. He called you to have confidence. Because this is when you're assigned, and the Lord will prosper you when you've been assigned to prosper. Thank you, God, for support. I want to pray just to give you a short word that I have. I just want to really emphasize that all the other names fade away. Let it all fade away. you got so many bigger things to worry about that you're missing everything. You got a sick family, you got financial calamities, you got different things happening. I'm simply telling you, don't let people steal your focus. God brought you to the almost end of the year, and you tripping at the almost end of the finish line. Think about it. God brought you all the way to November 9th or 10th. And now you tripping about January 20th? It doesn't even add up. God said that thing like, haven't y'all lived through a recession before? Outside, that moon is still going to be right there because the king is sitting on the throne and he hears your concern. God is not an unjust God the way he don't hear the concerns of his children. And some of you went through a hell year and it's been just terrible and it's just been hard. Not everybody's had a wonderful year. It's been a rough year for some of you. But everybody has a season that Satan will try to use to break you from who you are. If you quit at this stage, you never really had it in you to begin with. He that takes his hands off the plow and returns was never fit for the kingdom to begin with. I don't care if you have to hop to the finish line. If God has gifted you with breath and life in your body, he's still carrying you to the finish line. Go home tonight and open up the doors and tell anxiety to leave. Open up the windows and tell stress to leave. Open up the doors and let hate go out. Like, you're not going to fill me with hate. You're not going to fill me with this. Stay true to God, and I believe that God can prosper you where he is. Just find the three people as you go back and see Usher's circle lights on. So stop tripping, stop tripping, stop tripping, stop tripping, stop tripping, stop tripping, stop tripping. Reverend Enoch. Well, how many of you are glad to be in the house of the Lord? Because now you know you're blessed, you're not stressed, you're not, you're none of the below, you're being cared for, you're being manicured by Heavenly Father. It is a wonderful opportunity to see you in the house of God. Don't forget our prayer line. Last week, there was a little mix-up on the prayer line number. They should have given you the correct ones when you came in. And I want you to call in on Monday with us and be part of the prayer line. Pastor, you want to jump on? I want you to jump in on that. It's important that we pray. Don't forget, the movie is this weekend. The movie is this weekend. Get your tickets in the lobby. Please get in the lobby today. As well as the singles are having their event. It's an opportunity to have a good time. If Daniel, I'm not sure if he's here, or Nate will be here to give you the tickets in the back. It's a small fee, but you're going to have a good time at this event. So please, please take advantage of it. I want to read you Exodus 3, and then I want to go home because I think it's been echoed and it's been said. Verse number 6. I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Y'all saw that? That's a place to just pull you away, pull your hair out right there. I am the God. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. God is showing his generational provision for his children. I've looked out for Abraham, I've looked out for Isaac, and I looked out for Jacob. He's establishing that I'm a God that can be traced and I can be trusted. I'm not just your God, I'm the God of Abraham. If that ain't good enough, I'm the God of Isaac. If that doesn't prove anything to you, I'm also the God of Jacob. I want to give you a lineage and a picture because a God that can be traced can be trusted. But he goes further down and says, listen, I don't want to just enthuse you with the understanding that I'm going to start the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. There had been a window where it seemed like God wasn't hearing his children. It appeared that there was a moment where God just seemed to be silent. And it seemed like God had totally forgotten about the misery that his children were going through. People were tweeting that God had forgotten. People were texting and saying maybe God had left us alone. And all of a sudden God is showing us that he's a God that is so detailed in the lives of his children that he stops Moses and says, Moses, I want you to come here. I want you to know, number one, I'm not just your God, but I'm also a God of generations. Generations have trusted me and seen that I have not failed them. Generations have heard of me and seen that what I say I want to do, I do for them. But I don't want you just to forget about that, Moses. Moses, I want you to also know that it's been made aware to me that my children are going through a time of some serious calamity. And in this text is exactly what God says. He says, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. Somebody say Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them out of that land into a good and spacious land. Verse number 9, and now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way Egyptians are oppressing them, so now go. I'm sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. I want to just kind of just simply talk for 7 minutes and 22 seconds about Egypt and what Egypt really is. Egypt was a place of bondage, but Egypt was not just a place of bondage. Egypt was a type of mentality. And the fight that most of us are fighting is not necessarily the condition that we're in, but the mentality that we bring to the condition that we're in. Say it one more time. Most of us are not fighting the condition that we're in. We're fighting the mentality of the condition that we're in. When they were in Egypt, they were taught a certain way. It wasn't God's way, but that's the way that they were taught to get them to hold on to what the Egyptians wanted them to hold on to. And if you're not careful, the information that you're receiving will start transforming the way that you're supposed to think. And fear will start coming upon you, not because fear is really there, but because of the way that you think brings fear upon you. Because as a man thinketh, so is he. So God raises up a liberator to rescue them from Egypt. But if you study Old Testament clearly, Egypt is oftentimes a type of thinking pattern. And all we came tonight and you felt how liberating it was because we just changed your thinking from Egypt to kingdom. Because when you start thinking in Egypt, you start getting paranoid, you start being in fear, you start looking around, you start thinking and start getting nervous because you allow fear to come upon you when fear is a spirit that needs your invitation. I made up in my mind tonight to convince you to not invite fear into your home and to make up in your mind that I will not receive what fear is giving me, because fear is just trying to get me to think like I'm still in Egypt. Well, there's no purpose of thinking like you're in Egypt when God sent a Savior to bring you out of the thinking pattern that you have to go right back to that same thinking pattern. Yes. So he says to Moses, I'm not just going to deliver them, but I'm going to send you. This is the part that I want to put responsibility on you. God is just not saving or rescuing you from Egypt so you can shout about being out of Egypt. He's saving you to go get others who are in Egypt to change the way that they think so they can see their life the way that God sees them. See, you could be in the land of the free, but still be stuck in the land of Egypt because you're not looking at your freedom. You're thinking about the bondage that doesn't even exist, but you're putting yourself in a bondage that is not even real because you're allowing fear to grip you and make you immobilize. From what, remember this, whenever there's fear, agenda moves. Where people are afraid, agendas move. And I don't care what the world is telling you, you gotta hold on to that conviction of faith. The king sits on the throne of my heart, and I will not let anybody cause me to take him off the throne of my heart and miss him by trying to entertain people who never knew him to begin with. If God brought you through November, trust that if he can take care of 11 months of your life, if he can take care of 38, 32, 35, 34 years of your life, he got the rest of it pretty good. He got a good track record of being able to do what he do. So you just need to go to bed. Stop letting information change your thinking about who you are and what God's capacity and ability to do in your life. But he didn't just say, like, once you've gotten that God's the king on my heart, he's like, I need you to go to Egypt too. Because I need you to pull other people who are stuck there to let them know, girl, you're tripping. Get yourself out of Egypt and start thinking like the kingdom. He says, seek ye first the what? And all of these things, I am in my heart, I see opportunities of God's redemptive hand, because as a country, in a church body, we've been lulled without putting our full confidence in God. And before God allows tragedy to bring us to him, he allows different seasons to happen. So if you can catch what's happening in the seasons, you can see God's hand being in it. Like, don't miss God. Don't miss the wave because because you're afraid of the hurricane coming. Like, enjoy the waves that are hitting you now. Don't let fear intimidate you. I believe with all my heart that God will be more personal to you if you stop looking at all the distractions and you just say, Lord, whatever you're doing in this season, just keep doing it without me. God is using multiple things to get our attention, to bring us to a place of brokenness to where we can say, Lord, whatever you want from my life, whatever you're saying to my life, my answer, not because I have trouble, not because I have burdens, my answer will be, and some of you, I can sense it, are just saying to yourself, I just want to quit. And let me tell you something. You got too much evidence to quit. There are some of you in this place that are so spiritually asleep that you're physically present, but silently you quit. I just paused because I heard it to tell you you got too much evidence to quit. You forgot that God has an assignment for you, and you're letting everything but Him draw you to your assignment. Because the noise has drowned out what you should be hearing. Because you're so concerned about what you're seeing. Because what you're seeing is nowhere as important to what you're hearing. This is your moment to walk on the sea of fear and tell fear, I have a Savior who's already walked on top of me. Yeah. That's what I say to you. Encourage. Be not afraid. For I am with you. You're in a crowd of people and you feel alone. You're pretty popular. People know you. You've got a lot of friends, but you're just so alone. You're in the crowd, but the crowd is not with you. You're walking with people, but you feel disconnected from people that you knew and that you loved, and they don't understand you anymore. You're wondering what in the world is happening. I feel like I'm on an island by myself. I feel like nobody cares about me. I feel like everybody is turning against me. I feel like I just don't know where to go. And all God's asking you to do is just stop and pause. The only reason why you feel like the world is against you, the only reason why you feel like it's heavy, the only reason why you feel like things are not going the way that you anticipated to go, is because God separated you just to get a date with you. Come on, hear what I'm telling you. God just separated you so that he can get a date with you because you were so busy. He couldn't get your attention. You were so preoccupied with things and people and circumstances that God had to mix it up a little bit just so he can get that one-on-one passionate time with you. And while you're in the presence of the King, Exodus 3, verse 5, he says this. Take your shoes off. Not just take your shoes off. Don't tell me about the season of loneliness. Let me allow you to worship me so I can reveal to you who you always been, but you never seen. Because you do know Moses was walking with himself for 80 years and never realized within himself was a deliverer. And it is possible to be living with yourself every day and not see the big thing in the mirror that says who you are. And God just tries to steal you for a season just so he can reveal to you who you've always been and introduce the old you to the new you. But the only way he can get you to see the new you is if he can get you to pause long enough so that you can introspectively see what's really on the inside of you. Don't think for a moment that isolation is God's way of messing with your world. Sometimes God isolates you to reveal to you who you were, but you could not see it because there were too many people around you blocking the image that he was trying to transform you into. What you do is a while. You learn that seasons of loneliness are not always bad. There are times where God will pull you away. There are times where God will let the world seem like the bottom come out just so he can get you alone to take you on a date. To be able to look you in your eyes and say, you've been living way beneath your potential. You've been short-circuiting yourself, short-cutting yourself, making yourself feel like you do not qualify. But Moses, what I want to tell you is when you worship me, I'll reveal to you who you've always been. I didn't make you this person. You always were that person. It just took me to reveal to you who you were. And tonight I pray that you will walk into, even if it's the darkest season of your life, that you would hold the lantern that stays close to your heart. I didn't say everybody's gonna walk into a great season. I said it may be a dark season in your life, but I pray that you hold the lantern that keeps everything bright. Heaven and earth shall pass away, my word. Heaven and earth shall pass away, my word, my word, my word. Guard your ear gate. Out it flows. Issues of life. I don't want to hear everything, because not everything that's said is meant to be heard. You have some confidence in yourself. Shake yourself loose and understand the God that you serve. Go to bed. Put your legs up. Relax. He's still on the throne. Do you understand he's still on the throne? Would you look at somebody that looks scared and say, he's still on the throne? For some, it was, let me down change a little bit. For some, it was what I call a stripping year. You were stripped of everything you trusted in. It's, some, it was a year of figuring out that this is the lowest I can ever get. this was the worst year for some, and you're trying to figure out, well, what is, where am I here? But man, this was a terrible. Just because it was a terrible year doesn't mean you're a terrible God. And some of you went through a stripping season. And you know, something that's interesting about stripping seasons is it really stinks to go through it. It's not fun about being stripped. But you know what's interesting about this floor? In order to put shine on it, you got to strip it. And it will go through a season of ugliness, because the season of ugliness is the preparation for the shine that has to go upon it. You want the shine, but you don't want the ugly. You can't have both. You cannot want just to be pretty and not go through the ugly stage. You see, the thing that makes it hard for believers is you're laughing or you're pointing at someone who may be in a shining season, but they went through the same season you went through. The difference is they're on the other side of it. And you cannot want God to give you more without Him taking less of you. I'm scared of people telling God I want more. I don't think they really know what they're asking for. God, you want more. I just want more. Well, more of you means, more of Him means less of you. And until God can fully look in the floor, because the objective of buffing it is to be able to walk over it and look down on it and to be able to see yourself. And you know what was funny, when you were stripping this floor before we buffed it and then brought it back to dull shape, was sometimes they would have to strip it 6 or 7 times to get it right. You ever feel like God brought you up and took you down, brought you up and took you down? Well, when He brought you up, He looked at you and said, they ain't ready yet. I gotta strip them a little more. You still on that floor? Yep, I'm stripping. Because the greater the stripping, the easier it is to apply the shine. And if you're being stripped, at least you know who's doing the washing and waxing of your life. Trust the finished product will come out better than what you're experiencing. Have faith in God. By His. Father, I just want to hold a conversation with your children and tell them to be not afraid. That you are in control of their life. To encourage them to hold on to their conviction of faith. And He had begun a good work. He's going to complete this thing. So give us the faith to trust, even when we don't know where to go. So prosper our posterity, our lineage, with the things of God, the faith of God that we need. Help us to believe, even when we feel like we don't believe. You heard us. You know us. We're your children. Help us not to doubt who you are. It's in Jesus' name we pray. You know, Garcia, what's your mom's name again? I forgot. Susan, how many times has the doctor told you you wouldn't make it? The year before, he said he wouldn't be here. Did you hear what she said? Her family was looking for a funeral spot because the doctors told her she's not going to be here last year. She's still here. You can't let fear get into your heart. God's in control of everything. Even the tears we cry. He's not an unjust God not to forget the tears that you shed. Let's honor the Lord. Let's trust in Him. Let's believe in His word. That not not afraid, I am not intimidated. I still believe God's best for his children. He knows his plan for his children. Listen, our ushers are beautiful, wonderful, gracious, hospitable ushers. They're going to receive our giving. In this moment, this is a good time to give to God. Give where your kingdom belongs. Matthew 6 says, don't set up treasures where moth and rust destroy, because they'll eat it up. But this is the moment to invest in the harvest of heaven. Put your seed in the ground and watch what God does for you. Every one of you, put your seed in the ground. Whether it's $15 tonight, you can give a gift of 15. Put your seed in the ground, in the soil. My heart is not in this kingdom, it's in God's kingdom. Ushers are serving God. For once, I brought cash to do it because I knew what I was asking. 15 sold on the tablets of your heart. Text the gear, they have that on the screen if you so desire, so online. Give what belongs to God, everyone in this room. Give what belongs to God. The tenth is His. Return it with great joy and passion.